privilege of introducing speakers to you tonight. The first person is someone that I think many of you will be familiar with. That's Jack Wyant. He's been with Freedom Party now about 6 years and ran for Freedom Party in the 1990 provincial election. And his involvement, he was one of those people that just started off slow and has built and built, has continually been getting more and more involved with the party. And right now I'd like to introduce to you Jack Wyant.
Seem to have a god, you know, and it was Zeus or it was Christ or whoever, they had to have some sort of objective concretization of this form of what they thought of as an ideal. And I think now we sort of understand, we're coming to a point in our evolution, really. It's a worldwide movement, and Freedom Party represents something that is really found nowhere else in the world. I mean, even if you look at the Reform Party or a lot of these movements that are around, the conservatives, they have a lot of the right ideas, but they're not philosophically based. They don't understand the real essence of what their policies are about. I know my good friend Elijah Eliaf, we were talking the other day about what motivates a group is when you share ideals or you share values together, and the motivation that comes from that, it comes from the action. When I first started reading about Alexander, this was what amazed me, because so many of the followers, so many of the people in the whole society all related the same sort of ideas together, and they just, it justified them, it gave them great confidence and energy to go and work for that, because they knew that it was worthwhile, they knew that it was worth putting everything into, and that's what it was all about. And it's hard to talk about Freedom Party like this with people a lot of times, because you feel like you're almost talking about religion. People, oh, it's the answer, you know, it's going to save the world and all that stuff. But it's not just Freedom Party per se as such, it's the ideals that the people in Freedom Party believe in, freedom and individual rights, and freedom of choice. And I just want you to know how much appreciated you are, and that there are people out there like you working all the time. People who aren't here now, who couldn't come for one reason or another, who don't like dinners or aren't around, who are busy or don't want to come to a function, who are out there doing very important things. And I want you to know that you're involved in something too that you can be proud of, that you can be confident of, that you can feel is a noble cause when you're out there, to be proud of what you're doing, and that we're thinking of you. And there are other people around that share your values that are under attack so much in these modern times. I had a quote from Aristotle I wanted to stick in. I might as well stick it in here. He said that pleasure is the actions of the present, the hope for the future, and the remembrance of things past. We learn from the past, and when I've looked back in history and seen that only a scant really 2,000 years ago did we begin to understand ourselves and the world around us, that's all we have to learn from is the past. We can learn about ideals, and we can learn where we want to go and how to use action in the present, which is the only place we have to act, to obtain our goals in the end based around our ideals and our values. And we have hopes for the future based on that. But we have to understand what these ideals are, and that they are important, and that we can work harder and harder and harder and redouble our efforts, and we'll just get more and more reward all the time. But anyways, that's enough time for me. I had wanted to say a lot more. I sort of drew a blank. But that's enough seriousness for now, for me anyways. I pictured myself being the last speaker, and I can say to everybody, you know, recognize that everybody here is your friend. Talk to people, you know, have a good time, and by all means, have fun. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Jack. Hopefully, we will have the fun after we hear the last speaker. Jack was a little upset when he said that he had to go first, and I pointed out to him that I had to go first, so he was really second. So, but now we come to who honestly is the second speaker. Now, this is someone who's literally grown up with Freedom Party. Her father is Robert Metz, and she's just started being active, I guess. Her first article was printed in the last consent issue. I'm sure there'll be more of that to come. So right now, I'd like you to welcome warmly Danielle Metz.
I've been with Freedom Party since its conception. Or is that the other way around? Has it been since my conception? The quirk of fate that has made me the daughter of the president of an organization such as this has placed me in an unusual position. Unlike most of you, I didn't experiment with other political affiliations or philosophies, and so that raises some obvious doubts. I mean, obviously I'm going to support the party. I was indoctrinated at such a young age. My father's the president, so obviously I'm going to support what I was taught to believe. But this isn't what I was taught to believe. I was in the public education system for the last 11 years and still am in a limited way. When free trade first became a major issue in the last federal election, I was involved in a class debate on the issue. The entire class, including the teacher, against me. I've had an English teacher try to tell the class that our senses are fallible and therefore we shouldn't trust them, and in effect, we shouldn't trust our minds. I'm currently taking an economics course in which they try to tell us that a command economy, otherwise known as communism, can solve the pitfalls of capitalism, such as unemployment, inflation, depression, and the exploitation of workers. They also tell me that the benefits of a command economy and a market economy are equal, that each can harm or benefit a society dependent on the economic purpose of the government. So you see, I was not taught to think this way. In fact, peers, teachers, coworkers, and just about everybody else has tried to dissuade me from thinking this way. And I must admit, they almost succeeded. When I left high school 3 years ago, I realized that I didn't truly know anything. I didn't even know how to think. All I had were all these unrelated facts floating around in my mind, and I didn't realize that there was a fundamental connection between them. Realizing this, I had to sit down and teach myself how to objectively reason things out. I had to learn that there's a reason why every time you drop a ball from midair, it falls to the ground. I had to learn that there's a consistent set of objective rules that not even the government can legislate itself around. Once I understood this, the newspaper finally developed into something more than just a collage of random events. I understood that the political and economic hole our country has dug itself didn't just inexplicably happen. There were signs every step of the way, but nobody could read them. I also saw, for perhaps the first time, that the members of Freedom Party had predicted each of these events with a great deal of accuracy. They understood that gravity is the reason why that ball falls to the ground, and that no matter how many times you drop it, no matter what color it is, no matter the intention of the person dropping it, it is going to fall to the ground each and every time. Freedom Party operates on a consistent set of fundamental principles. The members operate on reality, and that's why I support them, and that's why I'm here tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Danielle. I had to stop because you reminded me of a quote that's in that same consent that you were published in, which was to Thomas Jefferson, that the man who reads nothing at all knows more than the man who reads only the newspapers. It's an interesting perspective, of course, that you have to have input from other areas and think things through. You can't just have something fed to you and accept it. Continuing on, right now, this is someone who actually lived in the same apartment complex that I lived in at the time. And I remember when you first sent in, I think I sent you a note saying, drop by, we'll talk, anything like that. That was back in 1985. Since then, you got, again, like Jack, more and more involved in the LMTC. And Robert Vaughn is currently the party secretary, has been since 1990, and he's our next speaker. So again, will you welcome Robert Vaughn.
Well, I wish I'd been the first speaker after listening to Danielle. Frankly, I have a problem with the name Freedom Party. And it's not the Freedom Part, it's the Party Part. Because I don't consider Freedom Party to be a political party. And to actually think of taking a concept like freedom and putting it into a political battlefield where one party is competing with another party, freedom is somehow sullied because it's in an arena with things like communism and socialism and tyranny. And so the word party, Freedom Party, disturbs me. I look at Freedom Party as a social club. I like everybody here. don't feel it. I can talk to everybody here freely. They know why I say something. They we disagree on minor points. But it's a social club. It's a good feeling to belong to the Freedom Party. More seriously, it's an educational institution. I think perhaps foremost, it's an educational institution. It's a long, hard battle to try to get people out there to understand the principles that Danielle has come to understand. Those loose facts out there in the newspaper, the racism, the sexism, the socialism, rent controls, things like this, all have a common thread. They all deal with philosophy. And it's Freedom Party's 50% Freedom Party's goal is to go out there and educate people that, yes, things are related. And the ball one drop does fall. And about every 4 years, 3 or 4 years, this thing called an election gets in our way, basically. I think that Bob described it to me like that. And we have another election, you know. Just in the middle of this good campaign, an election comes along, you know, spoils things. Unlike other parties, though, we usually come out in the black at election time. We have more money. We get more support. And the Freedom campaign grows. And I feel very privileged, very honored, and I find that Freedom Party is an integral part of my life. When I moved here to London in 1985, I wasn't particularly pleased. I'm from Newfoundland, and there isn't a hill here to be seen. So I was quite disappointed at the scenery and longed for a more scenic place to live. And economics dictated otherwise we had to stay here until, and I longed to find another place until I found Freedom Party. A co-worker mentioned Freedom Party to me. I've been involved with the Libertarian Party before and their ideas. Found out about Freedom Party, and now I can't find a good reason to move because there's no Freedom Party anywhere else. I guess I could move to places like Barrie and be the Freedom Party up there, or go back to Newfoundland and start a Freedom Party of Newfoundland, but still I wouldn't have the camaraderie and the understanding that I share with you people here tonight. Again, I feel privileged and honored, and I'm glad Bob asked me to speak. I really wish you would have had Danielle last, now that I've heard her. Okay, I'll turn it back to Lloyd and get on with the evening.
Speaker of the evening. This is a man that's been around for quite a while with Freedom Party. Let's see. Right from the very beginning. I guess maybe the best way to think about it is there's an idea that goes around, and you've all heard it in, you've heard it where you work, or you've heard it, you know, in any social event, in any gathering you've been in. There's this idea that if the majority of people are doing something, you should be doing it too. And what I look at is I see a world of politics where we have a whole series of parties that are trying to drive a square peg into a round hole. And they're all going to try to do that. They'll just use a different hammer or a better hammer. And I've got to admit, many of us are tired of being pounded by it. But all along, there's been someone that's been saying, you've got to go back to the beginning. You've got to go back to the basics. You got to put away the square peg, put away the hammer. And he's been standing there for with Freedom Party since 1984, with this round peg and a round hole saying, see, it fits. And I guess a big part of it, tying to rubber. It's educating and trying to get people to know that this round peg does work. It does fit. And so I guess right now I want to introduce the man that thought of a round peg and a round hole, Robert Ranzan.
Messages are over now. All my work's been done for me, and I can take it easy from here on. Before I get underway with my basic message for the evening, we have to have our usual traditional occurrence that we have at every one of our dinner events, and that's the awarding of our Freedom 200 pins, which some of you are wearing and some of you are aware of as these little gold pins that are awarded to those of you who have basically there's three criteria to get one, who've either been with the party for at least a year or more consistently, who generally give more than what's expected. I mean, these are the people that really come to all of our dinners, they support us financially, they support us when we ask for assistance throughout any sort of campaign. And the other criteria of getting one of these pins is that they have to be publicly awarded at an event such as this, at an event where all our other members are present. And so, in the interest of saving some time tonight, I would have 10 to award. What I'd like to do is just read out the names, and then when I'm done reading the names, we'll have those 10 people come up, and I'll hand each of them one of these pins. There are only 200 of these pins ever going to be awarded. We're now at around the 65 to 70 level. I didn't actually check the accurate count before I came in. So, some of these people may be surprised that their names are going to be called. Others may be maybe expecting it, I don't know. But here are the names for tonight. These are 10 more people to add to our growing list of Freedom 200 pin recipients. Carol Fitzgerald, Carol Ranzan and Conrad Ranzan, Silvio Ursomarzo, Kim Malcolm, Nick Whitehead, Trudy Moody, and Carol Vandenberg, and Joel and Kathy Byway. I think that's 10 right there. So if you'd all like to stand up, and we'll give you a little round of applause. And come on up here. Wonderful headline in the London Free Press that was just in the paper in the past week. I don't know if you knew it, but the deficit is a hoax. Did you know that? That was right on the front page of the London Free Press. Deficit hysteria labeled a hoax. And I think this is sort of indicative of the kind of mentality that is being driven by the media, particularly at large, and why so many people have a difficult time trying to understand the issue, trying to understand why things are starting to go wrong with Canada once the second standard of living in the world, second highest standard of living in the world. I think a number of these things were commented on by some previous speakers, but this kind of thing is still going on constantly in the media everywhere. We see here a drive, a very strong drive from the left wing wanting to entrench what it obviously sees as being under attack now. More and more people are coming to see there's some problem with the country. And it's not because of any philosophic allegiance or any particular learning or understanding, but because of what we see back there on the computer screen, for example. The daily minute-by-minute ticking of that time bomb. That deficit that is surely going to do something to Canada in the very near future. And I have a number of people repeatedly asking me, what kind of future can we expect? if that deficit keeps running at the rate that it's running. We're going to take a reading of that deficit again at the end of the evening and see how much it went up since the beginning. But we have examples to find out what could happen to Canada if we don't get that deficit in control and if we don't look at some alternatives in the way we handle some issues. I have to thank a friend of mine who's also a Freedom Party supporter from way out west in Calgary, and he sent me an interesting article from a magazine called Alberta Report. And it relates to an episode of W5, the news program, and as irony would have it, this very program that I'm going to tell you about right now is going to be on again tomorrow night on CTV. I think it's 8 o'clock, I'm not too sure, but if you get a chance to tune in, 7 o'clock, check your local listings. But in any case, tomorrow night on W5, I'm told that the same episode will air. And what the episode basically was about was what happened in New Zealand when finally the credit crunch hit. What really happened in New Zealand when finally their deficit reached a point where the international monetary community said, enough is enough, that's as far as you can go. According to that story in this article, up until 1984, apparently, New Zealand had been something of a socialist paradise. It was compared on par with Sweden, many other countries that a lot of people are still talking about as, quote, socialist paradise. They had socialized medicine for about 30 years. Their socialized medicine even included drug plans and all sorts of things that aren't included in ours. It was a politically correct country. Apparently New Zealand was a haven for Greenpeace. It wouldn't even allow American naval destroyers into its shores in the fight against communism. It had broken off relations with South Africa. And before 1984, it had third highest standard of living in the world. Now, how did it get that standard of living? Unfortunately, just like Canada is doing it now, by borrowing money, by buying today and worrying about paying tomorrow. And just as in Canada, apparently, back then, as the deficits were climbing, all the politicians were saying, we deplore this, we're going to do something about it. But of course, every party that got elected did nothing about it. And then it happened in 1984, shortly after a socialist government was re-elected, or took office rather, the finance minister had to announce to the thunderstruck cabinet that there was no more money and that the latest bond issue that they had put out, the New Zealand government, no one was buying. So without warning, their credit had been cut off and they were in default. So now politicians couldn't say anymore, well, we'll do something about it later, vote for us now, you know, we don't have to worry about things getting bad yet, because things are bad now, today. So I think it would serve Canadians a good lesson to see what could happen if we don't address some of these problems while we still have the opportunity to do so. You know, they were at the point where when their credit was cut off, they couldn't even pay their own employees, civil servants couldn't be paid, no one could be paid. So what happened? Here was a situation, apparently. At the time New Zealand got cut off, its foreign debt had reached 47% of its gross domestic product. Canada now stands at 44%. Its total government debt stood at 62% of gross domestic product, or gross national product. Canada's is now, believe it or not, at 88%, which is a lot worse. And like Canada, New Zealand had expected to grow its way out of the tax problem. Yeah, we'll tax it tomorrow. We'll catch up to the whole situation down the road sometime. But of course, that didn't happen. Their credit was cut off. And here are just some of the things that New Zealand had to do to survive the crunch and is still doing today. The first thing they did when they found out their credit was cut off at home, they told all their embassies in every one of the countries that they had an embassy in to go and borrow all the money that they could borrow in those countries and send that money back to New Zealand. Farm subsidies were eliminated overnight. No questions, no debates, nothing. No more farm subsidies, period. Crown corporations were cut back, sold, auctioned off. Air New Zealand was bought by the Australians. The telephone system was bought by the Americans. The insurance plan was sold. More than 700 post offices were closed and three quarters of the remaining were privatized. half of the government broadcasting system, their equivalent of RCBC, was laid off. Nearly three quarters of their 22,000 railway workers were laid off and lost their jobs. The irony, as the author points out here, is that today their railway moves more freight than it ever did in its history. The New Zealand dollar was devalued by 20%. In the 70s, that dollar was worth $1.40 US. It's now worth 50 cents US. Some of the things on the W5 program, they showed in a fashionable Auckland suburb, raw sewage going down the front lawns of all these expensive homes because the city or whoever takes care of the sewers and everything down there didn't have enough money to pay for any repairs. Their ships now bring mostly used cars from countries like Japan to sell to their citizens. And I've seen this in a lot of other third world countries. You don't get new cars, you buy used. They're imported from other countries. Perfectly shaped pine trees had been hewn that were cherished in a national forest. You had to chop them down, sell them to the Japanese. A baby hippopotamus that was born at a local zoo had to be shot because no one could afford to take care of it. And there was no money to keep the zoo going. Here's an amazing statistic. Unemployment had risen from an amazing, get this, 22 individuals in 1955. Can you imagine a country, 22 people unemployed? It went up in 1974 to 650 people unemployed. We now stand at 200,000 people unemployed. So you can see the scale of the enormity, but we're talking single digit numbers and then we're going to 200,000.
That's out of about 3 million
people. Yeah, of a smaller population too. A hospital user fee of $50 a day is charged to everyone in the upper half income bracket. Food poisoning apparently had become rampant in restaurants because they didn't have people to inspect and there wasn't enough money in the economy for people to go to restaurants often enough to turn the food over. The native Maori whose living conditions once far exceeded those of the Canadian Indians, now inhabit settlements that look worse than the poorest of Canada's northern reserves. Government is in New Zealand is looking more like a business all the time. The Weather Bureau sells its weather forecasts to the TV networks. Hospitals have billboards on them on the side. Even police cars carry advertising. Civil servants are hired strictly on short-term contracts tied to a specific task and a specific function, and then they're left over. The farm sector, which was once heavily subsidized, has somehow survived. Now they cut them off, now they just changed their crops. Specialty products developed, exports rose. There are more farmers now than there were before. You can see, after 10 years, you think that with all the subsidies gone, there's no farmers need those subsidies. Isn't that what they always tell us? Marginal land is being returned to forest again. And it's interesting that New Zealand's premier talked about debt as being like an addiction to government. Until they can't get that fix anymore, there's really nothing that can stop them. So, you know, these are just a sample of some of the things you can see on that W5 program, and it's an idea of what could happen in any country where the debt is allowed to go completely out of control. So you can well imagine in Canada, situation like that should arise here, how Canadians might react. A lot of them would not understand, and they still don't understand, why things are happening the way they do. Examples of what we see in our newspapers is a perfect illustration of that. The kind of explanation, well, it's free trade causing all this problem. Not that debt, they don't want to look at that. That's the good news, because the more we spend, the more we can have all those nice social programs. And I hate to say it, but Canadians are really stuck on that way of thinking. And we can complain all we want about politicians and about the people we elect, but the real problem, and I knew this when we started Freedom Party, is with us, the people. And that's where the change has to take place. You're not going to change your politicians at the top of the heap until you change the people at the bottom or the way they think to put different people at the top of the heap. Now, when we started Freedom Party back in 1984, we had no illusions about this. I mean, getting elected is easier than you think. All you have to do is tell people what they want to hear. And then to do that, we have to sound just like the other political parties. It's amazing. You know, when we go to an all-candidates debate, how our candidates sound so incredibly different from what the other candidates of the other three parties sound. And what's even more amazing is how the other three parties, and some of the other small parties too, I'm afraid to say, all sound so much alike. They're literally telling people what they want to hear over and over again. So I'm pleased to say that since the beginning, Freedom Party has been consistently based on a set of sound principles and policies, which we're going to be doing a lot of talking about, particularly at tomorrow's event. But we're going to show you something in a minute, too, to show you how we promote these principles when we go to election. I think also that our candidates and we as a party have also addressed and had the courage to address issues when they need addressing, not when it's too late to do anything about it. I mean, we've addressed a lot of politically incorrect issues. I remember when we first started taking on Sunday shopping, that was politically incorrect. We were told when we put a full-page ad in the London Free Press, oh, you don't do that, you'll never get elected. Well, now we've got Sunday shopping. The NDP gave it to us and promised that they wouldn't. And it hasn't really changed that much for too many people, and it's a fact of life now. And you have to ask yourself, why did that happen? We were campaigning for free trade before there was any sort of North American free trade agreement. We were campaigning for lower taxes, and through the LMTC, the London Middlesex Taxpayers Coalition, we were the first to utter the phrase, zero tax increase, which everyone told us was crazy. Can't happen. Now you're hearing other people in the community at least using the phrase. And I'll tell you, zero tax increase is not only possible, I'm looking at a 50% tax decrease. That's my goal for the meeting. We talked about privatizing. We've been talking about privatizing and putting things back into the hands of the citizens since we were inaugurated as a party. And of course, we were also among the first to talk about ending universality. And you hear a lot of these issues now being talked by the major parties. Isn't that curious? Why is that? And why are they getting elected and we aren't? Well, that's something that we'll get back to in a little moment, but essentially, I think we're faced with a major task before us. Ours is more of a problem of trying to get the public to understand our point of view and to understand that what we're trying to do is in everyone's self-interest and will eventually be the correct thing to do. It's one thing to be able to do all the right things when your credit's been cut, but it's another thing to do it before your credit's been cut so you can avoid that credit being cut. So just to what I have here for you now, I want to show you something that was just from the last 1990 provincial election here in Ontario. And what we've done, I know most of you have probably never been to an all candidates debate, and I don't blame you really for not going. All candidates debates are usually among the most boring things you could possibly attend. Generally, my experience, and I was shocked when I first got into politics, I used to think people were interested. And when we went to our first all candidates debates, I remember all the candidates being shocked by how few people would show up. I once went to an auditorium where they set up like 600, 700 seats, and 15 people showed up. And that was a big crowd, I learned later. And that's in the middle of an election. You see all the, you know, everybody trumpeting their point of view in the newspapers, and you get, oh, there's this fervor, everybody must be really into it, and you get out to that all candidates debate, and nobody shows up. But you know where they show up? If you go to an all candidates debate and there's a crowd at least this size or larger, that crowd has been a predetermined self-interest crowd, a crowd looking for favors from government, and that's the only time you get a big crowd at an all candidates debate. And that's essentially the all candidates debate I want to show you that we have here. What we've done, this was recorded on August 27th, 1990. Now we have to remember that was, we were in a late summer election. Remember that at the time, David Peterson was our premier. Everyone was so mad at David Peterson for having called an early election. Everyone knew at the time, by the way, that he had called that election to try and avoid having to call an election during the recession that we've just gone through. Everyone knew that was coming. And I'll tell you, through the grapevine that I hear right now, everybody knows worse is yet to come. I hear politicians in all three levels of government, municipal, federal, and provincial, because we lobby them all, and we talk to them all, and I hear them talking like, you know, 24 to 36 months is all we've got unless we clean house quick. And that just might explain a little bit of what Bob Rae is doing and why he has to do it. And everybody thinks Bob Rae is abandoning his socialist principles. Don't be fooled for a minute, he's doing no such thing. remember that socialism isn't a system. It lives off capitalism. It's a parasite system. And it can't kill the host. If you kill the host, you've got no wealth to distribute. You've got to keep that host that's creating the wealth alive. And that's the point that Ontario has reached. We've lost so many businesses, so many jobs, that Ray has no choice. He has nobody to get that money. So it's very, you know, he's stuck at a situation now where he's going to be looking like the socialist government of New Zealand doing all the cutting. When he knows very well that he's in a situation that he just cannot deliver the promises that he's been given. And in effect, that's the same situation David Peterson was in the last election. The public hated him. I remember, boy, everybody said, I'm going to vote against those liberals. You know, and we've had it with PCs. PCs, you know, they had their chance. So people voted NDP not realizing that the NDP was advocating the worst of everything that they hated about the other two parties. And so they're here they are. They're learning by experience. So you've got to remember, this is the election that the NDP won. And I think, too, when you watch this tape, it runs for about 20-25 minutes. What we've done is we've edited out all the other parties' statements except for one person. You're only going to see basically three Freedom Party candidates. This was one of those election all-candidates debates where they had more than one riding on the stage. And it was held at the London Public Library downtown. And the tape you're seeing was originally broadcast live on the local cablecast system here in London. And what was particularly interesting was we were speaking to a special interest group, namely a nurses union. And a number of the issues that were concerning them, of course, was overall health care. Pay equity was a big thing at the time. And a number of issues relating, as you will see on the tape, to the same things you hear today in the papers. All the issues don't change over time. What was particularly curious is that the audience reaction, I don't know how well the sound will come across here as far as the audience can hear, but it was really funny to watch in retrospect, and I was sitting on the stage and watching, for example, Jack Plant and Barry Malcolm, who you'll also see on this tape, literally telling the audience the truth. Sorry, folks, this is the way it is. And the audience literally rejecting it. They didn't want to hear it. You know, they'd sit there, they'd nod their head, and you'd sort of push them and try to get a point across, and they sort of have to acknowledge it, but you can hear that they don't want to hear this message. And so I think that if there's one very different thing about Freedom Party candidates in general, is that we're not out there telling the public what they want to hear to get elected. That's not going to serve us in the long term. You know, we're in this for the long term. We've got a lot of work ahead of us. We've got to do it the right way. And one of the reasons I picked this particular clip is to show you what you get for your money in an election campaign when you're supporting Freedom Party. Now, this is also a very sensitive issue for some people, because we're talking about health care, and we all know how much, ultimately, all of us are going to have to depend upon that health care system at some point in our lives. And our health care system is in a lot of trouble. We've been saying that it's going to be in a lot of trouble for a long time. And here we had an opportunity, this particular all-candidates debate, to confront an actual interest group that wanted to see more government money spent that they had to acknowledge didn't exist on the healthcare system, and even to implement all sorts of socialist programs such as pay equity, which we told people right then and there, you know, pay equity means some of you are going to lose your jobs. And that's happened since that. So I think what we'll do now is I'll just start the tape, and I think you should be able to see it okay, and it'll run for about 20-25 minutes, and then I'll get back up and make a few more comments about what we saw and make some closing remarks. But I think you get a good idea of what we have to go through. Oh, I should also comment, this was, by the way, Jack Plant's first election campaign and his first time in front of a crowd, and never mind being on TV and the whole shot at the same time. And I think he performed incredibly well considering who we were facing, how we were doing, and the kind of opposition he was getting in some of the comments he was making. So I think you'll enjoy this, and I'll be back in a couple seconds. Okay. Anything happening on there? Yeah. Oh, just one other point, too. Is there a picture on there yet?
No.
I've left some of the questions edited in so that you'll understand what some of the answers are. We cut out everything else. We also left one response by NDP David Wininger in. So just to give you the context of the whole thing.
I think that maybe one of the ways we should get started off here is by defining exactly what the issue is that we're talking about here today. When we were in the back room there, we were being briefed, and the moderator told us that the term healthcare is a very broad term. It could mean just about anything to a different number of people. But I have to say that in this forum, this being a political election, this being a forum where you're electing people to represent you in government, we're not talking about healthcare the way a lot of people seem to picture it in their mind. The doctor-patient relationship. What goes on in the hospitals? What goes on between a doctor and a patient? No, what we're talking about tonight is how to pay for the healthcare system that we want. And one of the things that's been omitted by all the speakers that have spoken so far is that, quite frankly, we can't afford to pay for the healthcare system that we want in the way that we want it. There are taxpayers out there, and taxpayers are starting to get pretty fed up with the government constantly taking their money from them, constantly making promises to them that they're going to deliver this healthcare system, this education system, and all of it's falling apart right under our noses as the tax dollars keep climbing and climbing. It's not going to work, folks. There's no free lunch. It's time we accepted responsibility for ourselves. To that end, if we really want to see an accessible healthcare system accessible to everyone, we've got to take that healthcare system, the means of funding, away directly from the control of government. Government should not be running our hospitals. Each and every taxpayer should have a right to direct his healthcare taxes to the hospital of his choice, to the doctor of his choice.
Five seconds.
While this sounds simplistic in principle, it works. We have the evidence, and I invite you to find out. My time's up. Thank you for yours.
We will now begin with the questions. Some of these were solicited in advance from 60 groups around the city, and so we will begin with some of the questions that have come to us that way, and then questions will be coming to the front from those of you in the audience tonight as well. The first question is one that is directed to the parties. And I will begin with the preamble. The Public Hospitals Act requires election of staff nurses to all committees that deal with administrative, financial, operational, and planning matters at the hospital. Almost all hospitals have taken at least 18 months and a threat of funding loss to comply. Many have yet to comply. As well, healthcare agencies have ignored the government's intent for introducing pay equity, as outlined in the Pay Equity Act of 1988. Some employers have refused to disclose information or to negotiate an evaluation system. There are also problems with the Pensions Benefit Act in that the Ontario Hospital Association is not yet allowing part-time nurses to access that act or access the pension fund, even though they have the legal right to do so. The question for the parties is, how does your party intend to ensure compliance with the law? Do I have a taker for that question? Bob Wood? Bob Wood? Did you have your hand up? You were clapping. Good man. Robert Metz.
Well, how do you follow that answer, eh? If I recall, the question asked was, how do I intend to ensure compliance for the law? It seems to me odd that we're talking about the same institution that makes the laws is breaking the laws, because it's the same institution that's funding the hospitals. And it comes back to the same point again. Governments cannot meet their commitments or even obey their own laws simply because they can't afford to do it. One of the things the moderator mentioned was pay equity. Well, right now, pay equity, when you legislate it, you're going to incur an incredible expense upon your healthcare system. And in just doing that single thing, you're drawing away the dollars that could have gone directly into health care for patients. It's an unsolvable problem if we keep doing it in the collective way. We have to make citizens individually responsible for their own hospital bills. They can do that by purchasing private insurance, by directing their taxes to the hospital or doctor of their choice, and money can be raised voluntarily through a number of means. You know, I don't look at this as being pleasant. It's a hard job, and it's not as easy as asking for tax dollars. But the tax dollars have run out, and they're hurting our economy in every way. And the poorer our economy gets, the poorer our health care system gets. So we've got to start accepting that responsibility ourselves.
We'll move on next to our next question, which has come from our public health colleagues. Research shows that the health of the population is determined by such factors as housing conditions, type of job, and poverty, rather than direct health care services. All political parties seem to continue to either fund or call for increased funding to high technology areas of the illness care system, such as heart surgery or nuclear magnetic resonance machines. At the same time, children are our investment in the future. Yet thousands of children live in poverty, and mental health services for children, both preventive and treatment, are deplorable in Ontario. Explain what plans your party has to deal with this situation. Thank you. Robert Metz.
Thank you once again. I'd like to focus briefly on the whole issue of poverty and perhaps how it relates to health care to show how destructive we are to the poor in this province. One of the most backward ways to help the poor and to justify many of our social services is what we're doing today. Back in 1968, before there was such a thing as OHIP, 82% of the people in Ontario had private health insurance. Didn't cause a government deficit, didn't cause high taxes, and everybody's health care was gradually improving. But politicians noticed that 18% of the people weren't covered. And this was a problem, had to be overcome. But what did they do? Instead of directing their government assistance to the 18% that needed the help, they instituted a universal health care program where everybody helped himself. Now, it's pretty obvious why that's popular. Everybody wants something for nothing. And I have yet to meet the voter who honestly and truly believes that he would like to be taxed more for the other guy. I think too many people are using the poor as an excuse to get benefits for themselves. And that's what I think is disgusting about the way we handle our health care system and people who are poor. If someone cannot afford their health care, but for goodness sakes, let's help them out. Let's not send money to the whole health care system. If somebody can't afford their education, help that person out. Don't send it to the whole system. You can't afford a train ticket, help the person out who needs a train ticket. Don't subsidize a whole railway system. Is that the way we help the poor? Thank you.
Thank you much. The next question has actually come twice, and so it is asked the first time of all candidates and the second time of the candidates in London North. So I would ask that candidates in London North make a particular effort to answer this, since somebody's very interested in their views, but the question is open to all candidates. Increasing numbers of people are choosing to receive care at home. However, funding has not increased proportionately. Ultimately, it would seem the health care dollars could reduce or be reduced with the return to care at home. And specifically, the question is this: what are the strategies that are in place for palliative care in the community, both volunteer and professional, and what is yours or your party's position on palliative care? So this is a palliative care question open to all candidates with specific responses sought from London North candidates. Okay, I'll ask Jack Plant first.
I really think it's incredible that we're getting these kinds of questions, and all the questions are, what's government going to do? What's government going to do? Where are they going to get more money to give us? Is that what you really want? You're being taxed to death. Everybody's being taxed to death. Bob, I heard Snickers when Bob Metz mentioned everybody paying for their own health care. Do you want somebody else to pay for it? I assume that's the case. Government can't manage. Government cannot manage health care. They're not doctors. They're politicians. They're here to get your vote. Socialized medicine does not work. It hasn't worked anywhere in the world, and it won't work here. Canada is the only country in the world to make private basic health care illegal. In the Western world, I mean, the Russians and the East Germans have all done it, and we've done it too. Even in Britain, they have the two-tier system. If you want to help the older people, we could help them through charities. Help them. But don't ask government to do it again. You're asking government for more and more and more, and taxes are going up. The healthcare system is being destroyed. There's no money for it now. The taxes they're taking now are taxes that are paying for past bills. Costs are going up. It's an open-ended system. It's 30% of the provincial budget now. And where's it going to end? It can't go on. You just can't keep taking money this way. You have to privatize it. You have to get competition back into the system because it's not going to work. Our system is in the toilet, and all it's going to take is one good flush. And if we keep going this way, you just can't keep on taking taxes. We're destroying the productivity of our country and our province. And we're headed for destruction if we keep going on this week. We see it in all systems. We see it in transportation. We see it in energy. And that is the problem. Do we really believe that government can handle these things? I don't think government can run a hot dog stand. I just can't believe that we can look around and look at the failures of government and still want to put the responsibility for the handling of our health care and our education and all the things that are important to us into their hands. It has to be individual responsibility. The relationship between the patient and the doctor and the nurses has to be put back into it. The patient pays government, and the doctor works for government. And you have to go to government to get satisfied. It's not between the patient and the person providing the service. Thank you.
Final person to address this question is Barry Malcolm.
Thank you all. I heard dignity mentioned three times by three different speakers. I'd like to suggest to them that you can't have dignity without freedom, and you can't have freedom without responsibility. Along with that responsibility is one to look after our own health care. We heard Marion Boyd mentioned they should have a choice. Well, they don't have one now with the government funding. Sure, public health care, it's a public good. But there's nothing wrong with having it funded ourselves, self-insure ourselves, have an insurance company insure us. I don't see why in the productive sector that monopolies, which are only exist at the license of government, why they're such a bad thing, but when we get a monopoly run by the government, it seems to be a good thing. Why is that? I don't understand that. You know, I need someone to explain that to me. I've also heard a couple of speakers mention government funding. The government funding this, the government funding that. Well, the fact of the matter is the government doesn't have any money of its own except that which it gets from each and every one of us. Or borrows it, which incurs debt on our behalf. And I'm not so sure that should be even allowed constitutionally. If you come down to it, you're going to find people say, well, what about the rich? You know, the rich are going to be able to afford better care. Well, they are able to afford better care now. They go to the United States, or they make deals with hospitals. I shouldn't say that. I don't have any facts to back that up. I just go on the information of John Turner. When he needed his operation, he seemed to get it pretty quick while there were waiting lists. I think when it comes down to it, the only way that you're going to solve this is to get control of the healthcare system back in your hands and out of the politicians' hands. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can we have a response as to what you would do to ensure that nurses receive wages indicative of their worth? Jack Plant? Jack?
I'd love to see nurses getting paid what they're worth. But who decides what they're worth? Is it up to you to decide what you're worth? If you say, I think I'm worth 30 bucks an hour, then you go to the government and you say, I'm worth 30 bucks an hour. You should make this employer pay this to me. Is that how it works? The only way it can really work is by the pricing system in a free market economy. The consumer of the service is willing to pay so much, and the doctor is willing to pay you so much of what he can afford. My wife said to me the other day, how would you like to decide it? You want the government to decide? Well, my wife said to me the other day, she said, I can see under the system that you're advocating that if the doctors were allowed to pay the nurses what they decided, no, well, really, it's not just the doctors that decide. You decide what you're going to accept and what you're going to reject. If you don't want to accept it, you reject it. Don't work for it. My wife said to me, if a nurse went to a doctor and she was a good nurse and she knew she was worth $20 an hour, and she went to the doctor and he wouldn't pay it, he was only going to pay 10. So some bad nurse came along and he hired her and he was only paying her 10. And so everybody would hire bad nurses. Is that what the future sounds like to you? Do you think that's what would happen? Is that what happened before 1968? Were all the nurses bad? Well, who decides? You think you're underpaid. I think I'm underpaid too. I'm a firefighter. We have a monopoly on the firefighter labor in the city of London. The city has a monopoly on providing that service, just as you have a monopoly on the nurses' labor. The government has a monopoly on supplying that service. They're immune to market forces. So how do you decide? How do you decide?
I take it your position is that you're not going to take up the challenge of that question.
I beg your pardon?
I'm trying to summarize what I think your position has been to this point.
Well, nurses
that you
want
don't
to be,
see that it's an issue.
Well, they want to be paid what they're worth. Who decides? It's a deal you make with your employer. You reach an agreement. And if he doesn't want to pay you a certain amount, then you either work for him for less or you don't work for him. The only other way is to have the government force people to pay them what someone else tells them they want to pay them. You want to go to the government and tell the and lobby them and say, we're worth $20 an hour and we demand it. You pay it to us. And you're going to take it out of the taxpayer's pocket. It's a situation that there's no resolution for unless it's privatized. A good nurse gets the same as a bad nurse. Is that fair? In a private system, you could decide. The good doctors would hire the good nurses.
Well, order, please.
Then they suffer and patients wouldn't go to them.
Okay. I have a feeling you're going to have people at your office chatting with you about this one.
Okay. Thank you.
Robert Metz.
I have to agree with Carolyn that nurses don't work for doctors, but with doctors. But she didn't say who they did work for. Both of them work for the government. And it's the government that they're asking to increase their pay, and it's the government that doesn't have the money to increase it. So here comes a candidate like Jack to offer you another alternative, and you all laugh at him. Because, you see, I used to think that wages were determined by what people wanted. You figure you're worth something, and that's what you'll get if you work hard enough at it. That is not what ultimately determines the value of anybody's labor offering any service or any commodity. What ultimately determines that value is how many people there are competing offering the job, and how many people there are competing to buy the service. That's a fact of economics. It cannot be denied. Whenever governments try to thwart that fact, they screw up the whole economy. We don't advocate a free market as a matter of some sort of whimsical philosophy. We advocate a free market as a matter of acknowledging that it exists, that it's the only way that we can all get what we want. Now, if I was a patient, I would like to pretty well damn know that the person who's taken care of me, be that a doctor or a nurse, is well paid. I would like to know that I had the right to direct my taxes, my insurance dollars, my efforts to that doctor or that nurse of my choice. Health care is for patients. Health care is to make people feel better, to make them healthier. They're the people who should have the control. They're the people who should say how much they're willing to pay. They are the recipients of the benefit. In every place that you see this process in action, you will see a healthy economy. You will not see governments in deficit. You will not see a lack of a service. You know, there's an old famous example that if the government had been producing our shoes for the last 50 years, and a party like us came forward and suggested, well, we could solve the shoe shortage by turning it over to private enterprise and then listening to everyone laugh. Just take a look at the Soviet Union. Look at what socialism has done there. Look at what's happened to socialist medicine in Britain. Everybody is backtracking. It's not that we have a choice anymore. We have to turn things around because the health of our economy is where we get the wealth to pay for our complete health care system. So when we ask who decides, the answer to that question is you, the patient. That's who decides. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would certainly offer with the NDP a more responsive health care system. I wouldn't offer what the Freedom Party seems to create, a heartbreak hospital where the ambulance comes screeching up to the emergency ward. And unless you've been to the bank on the way to withdraw your life savings or sold the house, you don't get your open heart surgery. You're sort of rolled out on your stretcher into the gutter. That's the sort of healthcare system they envisage. And in fact, that's the kind of healthcare system the liberals are moving towards. It may be true that a third of our budget is spent on healthcare, but it's unwisely spent. For example, new corporate boardrooms at Victoria Hospital. How does that help patients?
5 seconds.
These monies should be spent on health care. Patients should not have to suffer because of nursing shortages, because funding isn't applied the way it should.
Time. Thank you. Robert Metz.
It's obvious, David, that you didn't hear a word I said all evening.
I heard that 3 years ago.
Yeah. And the hospitals are much better today than they were 3 years ago. I think the most important thing to point out now is that voters from now on, as you can see, there's a lot of candidates up here, and you're going to have a lot of choices to make. And you're going to have to get used to it because it's not going away. People are getting very dissatisfied with what the existing three parties are offering us. So I thought in order to distinguish Freedom Party from the rest, I'd tell you a few things about us. Number one, we believe that the purpose of government is to protect the individual's freedom of choice and not to restrict it. We think that governments should be there to prevent some people from imposing their obligations and their choices on others, not the other way around. We're not a single issue party. We didn't come into being because of an issue like abortion or whatever. We're here as a very broad-based party. We're not just all talk, we're all action, and I invite every person here to check our record of action. It's in print for anyone for the asking. Thank you very much.
Diane can promise you a lot of things, and Joan Smith can promise you a lot of things. Well, I can't really promise you what you want to hear. You know that. And I would think we'd learn now about politicians' promises. Every election we have promises. And we vote for the conservatives to throw the liberals out. The next election we vote for the liberals to throw the other way. I got mixed up. We go back and forth, and they make promises, and they make more promises, and they make more promises, and taxes keep going up, and up, and out of your pocket as we impoverish the people of this province. We can't escape the market forces in healthcare. Our province is in a crisis situation. As Robert said, you're asking for more money from government. Government doesn't have it. We don't have it. It's as simple as that. I don't understand why David thinks that if we brought in a system such as we're advocating, that everybody would have to take a trip
Five
to the
seconds.
Bank. 82% of the people in the United States have health care. They have the best health care system in the world. They spend more on it than we do. Joan Smith brags about our delivery system. When you have to wait 9 months for an arthroscopy and people are dying waiting for heart bypasses, I don't
Time.
Call that a good delivery system.
Get your facts right.
Well, I know when I had to go for an arthroscopy for my knee,
up.
The appointment was going to be 9 months. Is that
Jack?
Good delivery of health care?
Jack,
when
your time is up.
When it's accessible and you're accessible to nothing, is that good?
Jack, your time is up.
It seems to me the question was why I'm more likely to, why the voters should be electing me as opposed to the other members in the riding. The other parties seem to be fighting over control of what they're going to do with your lives and with your tax dollars. To me, I think I'm much different in the sense that I'm going to be going there not representing any special interests. I'm going to be going for less taxes. I'm going to try to give you back your dignity, your freedom, the responsibility of controlling your own life. I think it's too easy for the voters to be given this sense of security at the expense of your freedom. I think the socialist experiments all around the world have proven that. I don't think we have to debate any theories. I think the evidence is in.
5 seconds.
I think you need a new choice. On September 6th, I think you should choose Freedom Party. Thank you very much.
I don't even understand the simplest things about supply and demand curves, or the basic relationships, that if you just had a basic economics course, some of the things that people would be saying politically would seem stupid to them right at the face value of it. And that's one of the big things that's missing in this country today, and these things are not being taught in our schools. And they're not being emphasized, and they're not being stressed by any of the political parties. We're the only one out there doing this. We're the only one taking the risks, and I think that's the big difference between ourselves and the other political parties. We're taking the risks that leadership demands. The rest of them are just followership. Let's see what the public says. You know, I could just see it if we were operating our political party on polls. If when we first started campaigning for Sunday shopping, at that time the polls were saying, well, the majority of people don't want it. So I can just see me getting on the phone and phoning up Lloyd. Lloyd, this week our policy is we're against Sunday shopping this week. We'll wait till the next poll comes in and see if people want it next week, and then we'll be for it. And that's simply the way our political parties are operating today. And that's why we're in the trouble that we're in. It's one of the main reasons. So that's basically how we address issues at a typical all-candidates debate. This is one of those rare things that we were able to get on tape, because most of those kinds of confrontations aren't always recorded or available to look back upon. But I think that gives you a pretty clear idea of the type of things that we have to face during an election. And despite, you know, being on target with a lot of the things that we said about a lot of issues and seeing a lot of that happen today, being right, by the way, isn't the thing that's going to buy us votes. People don't vote for things, and that's what another problem we have with the electorate. People vote against things. And I'll tell you, this next election, it's going to be liberal or conservative. Same guys we threw out just in the last two elections, so we put the NDP in. We're going to just go around in circles, until that deficit goes right sky high. And that's the only option we have with the other political party. So enough for elections, just to bring you up to date on what we've been doing lately in terms of our real campaigns. Just looking back over the last 12 to 18 months, some of the things we're in. I'm not going to get into a lot of details on these issues. We're going to discuss a lot more of them tomorrow, those of you that will join us tomorrow. But one of the things we did in the past year, we got right in on the Constitution debate. And the Charlottetown Court issue was being held in the referendum. We were on the no side of that issue. And, quote, we won. But this was not a new issue for us either. It was a year before the referendum in 92 that we were already before the process for amending the Constitution federally in 91, saying all the same things that we knew were going to happen and that would happen and that did happen in 1992. In fact, our our submission that was made to the federal government, which was made on our behalf by William Frampton, is completely reprinted. I think most of you know the publication we put that in. It's called For the People. I think we have some copies that are available back there. But that was an issue that we campaigned on. We again have always, since the beginning, reiterated our strong opposition to censorship and again made another submission to the Ontario Law Reform Commission. We've recently touched upon a real taboo subject that nobody spoke about politics. And we're not on the politically correct side of the spectrum. And we don't think drug prohibition works. If you look at the evidence, if you look at the arguments, I think drug prohibition is one of the biggest causes of our drug problems today. And I think the evidence speaks fairly loudly for itself, and the evidence is just pouring through the gates right now. And I think we're going to see some big changes in this in the very near future. I don't think countries like the United States and Canada can afford to continue spending billions and billions of dollars to stop people from doing what they want to do, and in the process creating a big black market and a complete underground organized crime type of situation that's very artificial and it sort of feeds itself until we break that hole. There are other ways to deal with drug problems and put people in jail. We're currently protesting also on another issue. What the Ontario Elections Commission wants to do recently, we're not being treated yet as an equal party in elections, even though we have or have official registration status. We have a bigger problem that just came into the federal sphere. We participated in a big protest in Toronto, David, I think you were involved with that, against Bill C-114, which, as you know, federally has recently raised first of all, the candidate's deposit from $200 to $1,000. You can imagine what kind of restraint that will do or put upon people who can't afford that kind of thing just to run an election. We're supposed to be in a great country where anyone is supposed to be able to run. And you know what one of the justifications for this law is? The parties think that the ballot's getting a little too cluttered. So let's raise the ante. That's how simply they think. They also passed as part, or are still passing, actually it's in its third reading right now, as part of Bill C-114, a law that would prohibit any non-federally registered political party from running any ads or advertisements about anything political during a general election, if it costs them more than $1,000 to do that advertising or that ad. Now, I don't know if any of you have done some advertising in newspapers, but you can't buy a decent full-page ad for $1,000. That gets you a little corner of a newspaper somewhere if you're lucky. So obviously they don't want the message heard. And that's just one of our problems, and we're afraid too that now that this is a federal precedent, the same thing may happen provincially. You can imagine what this means on the federal level, that just in order to stick into an election for a smaller political party, they've got to come up with $50,000 just to stay in the election. Because federally you have to run 50 minimum candidates with $1,000 deposit on each one. That could be a formidable amount of money. I should also let you know that we as Freedom Party have been able to run very effective campaigns, including literature to every single person's home in our ridings, signs for all the people that want them, and all the appropriate backup for under $1,000. You don't have to spend a lot of money to have an effective election campaign. So that just goes to show you what people in the three main parties think about our democratic process. They don't even want us to participate. Education, we've been constantly lobbying and continue to do so for lower costs in education, for quality in education, and for choice in education, which we think is the ultimate objective to achieve the other two goals. We recently addressed Ontario's Fair Tax Commission. Matter of fact, we addressed it on the first day that they started their hearing, few weeks ago here in London. And as you know, the Ontario government is hungry for more of your tax dollars. It needs some more reasons to justify taking those tax dollars. So of course it'll create a fair tax commission, which is really a more tax commission, so that they can find out ways to justify the new taxes that are coming down the road. You know, they're talking about a wealth tax now. And I think a lot of people don't realize what a wealth tax is in terms of the way it's being discussed now. It means literally, folks, that if you've got a mortgage-free house, you're going to be taxed on that. Or if you have equity in your house, the difference between the value of your house and the mortgage you have on your house, you're going to be taxed on that. If you Because really, the new principle that's coming into, quote, principle, that's coming into tax collection now is the principle of ability to pay, which has always been the principle. It's never been any different. You can pay, you pay more. You can't pay, you pay less. Never mind the service you get or don't get. With that in mind, I should also point out we've been continuing on an ongoing basis to help locally and work with, and they help us too, the London Middlesex Taxpayers Coalition, which has been working on the municipal level and doing some wonderful things here in the city lately. And we can thank our good friends Jim Montag and Craig Stevens, who are over at the table there, who are members of the coalition, who are doing a lot of it. And of course, we do a lot of general public speaking, television, radio, and other speeches. We've been recently speaking to other groups and basically telling them our perspective on issues that we may have in common or not have in common. And of course, one of the other things, one of the most foreboding things to get away a little bit from the economic types of issues is another issue we've been addressing and really getting our teeth into this time is the Human Rights Commission of Ontario. I've never seen a body or an official body that's so misnamed as the Human Rights Commission. This commission exists specifically to deny people their rights. And if you think that's an exaggeration, you just have to go to one of their hearings to find out what I'm talking about. I did that. I went to the hearing that I had read so much about in the London Free Press. I heard about this terrible person that made these, quote, racist remarks against his tenants that he rented to in his building. His tenants apparently are of Asian origin. And the irony was that he rented 60% of his buildings out were rented to people of Asian ancestry. Because when the Cambodians and Vietnamese came here, this gentleman was kind enough to allow many of them into his low-cost housing. But as a consequence of doing that, he caught himself in a trap. In a trap of competing with the government for low-cost housing, because the government's got its own plan, and so do some social workers. And if you can claim to someone that they made a racist remark, you can drag them in front of the Human Rights Committee and say all sorts of terrible things about them. You know, the London Free Press quoted this gentleman as having made some remark calling his tenants something to do with pigs because of the cleanliness of their building. And this was reported in our local London Free Press, who said they had it on tape recorder and all this sort of stuff. When I got involved with the issue after watching testimony for 2 days at the Human Rights Commission hearing and listening to witness after witness getting up and saying that everything the London Free Press was saying was just not true, I stepped into it and I decided to work from the inside on this issue of the Human Rights Commission. I'm currently representing Mr. Elijah Elia, who happens to be the owner of the Cheyenne Apartments. Anyone in the London area knows about this particular situation. Mr. Elia is with us this evening, sitting over at the far table there. And the first thing I did when I agreed to represent Mr. Elia before the Human Rights Commission was I subpoenaed the London Free Press for the tape that they said that they had, which he supposedly uttered those dastardly racist comments. And guess what? There was no such. They sent their lawyers to the Human Rights Commission and argued there had never been such a tape, they never heard of such a tape, it never existed. And yet, I know from personal conversation and from testimony that was read into the testimony and from other conversations with people in the Free Press, oh yeah, we have a tape. And we have a whole system. They even explained to me how they put the tape in this envelope and they seal it with all the notes because they know if they ever get in trouble, they'll have to refer to it. And this is what we were told until we presented them with a subpoena and then the truth came out. But the London Free Press never reported that, folks. They never reported that, but they have stopped talking about the racist comments. And it's really tuned down a lot. So at tomorrow's event, for those of you who will be attending, you'll be seeing a clip that relates to that particular issue and the stink that we kind of caused locally about it. And the way that we have started to change a lot of Londoners' minds about what's going on behind these Human Rights Committee hearings and the things that are going on of that nature. There are some very scary pieces of legislation coming forward from this Ontario government that are non-economic in nature. They are literally starting to write our lives for us, telling us what our relationships should be based on and what premise they should be based on, who we can associate with, who we can't associate with, on what grounds we should associate. Don't say this to that person. Don't say that to that person. You could be hauled in front of them for anything. And now they're going to go even further, as many people who are in the hospitality industry and landlords, as they well know, we're going into something called systemic discrimination, where they're not even going to bother with individual cases. They go by statistics. You can go to an employer or a landlord and simply say, well, here's the racial and sexual breakdown in your particular neighborhood or in your community, and if your employees or your tenants do not match this same ratio, you are immediately guilty. Systemic discrimination is based on that. And I think it's laws like that that are creating a lot of the friction that we see more and more between groups, not just based on race, based on language. We've got the French versus English. We've got various interest groups competing with each other. And this is what naturally happens when governments get out of control. So you can see we've got our work cut out for us. We've got a lot of work ahead of us, a lot of elections ahead of us, a lot of campaigns ahead of us, a lot of education ahead of us. And I hope you'll be there with us through to the end to see us and help us and support us, because we always need your support. You know, sometimes it feels a little tough for me as an individual to approach so many of you, particularly those of you that already give help, and you give money, and you give your support, and you come to our dinners, and you show up at our meetings and our lobbies, and you're always the same people we've got to call back. You're always the same people that support us. And you're always the same people that give. Boy, please give, folks, because we sure need support. We've got a lot of work to do out there. But you're the folks that are going to do it. This is the party that's going to do it in the long run. For that, I want to thank each and every one of you, and hope you have a great evening for the rest of the evening. And we can talk on a one-on-one basis. Thank you very much.
My notes have disappeared.
You're right behind me.
Actually, the formal part of the evening is over. There's just one thing I'd like to do before we emphasize Robert's social club and start to enjoy the evening. And that's to take one downer, and I'm wondering if someone would take the time right now to tell us how much the deficit is. I'm just curious to see the national debt. Let's just take a look in the last... Sure, Brenda. You'll probably only get the first few because the other ones moved too fast. Okay, well, we were 497828 is the first six?
Yeah. Oh, 666161.
Okay, we won't go too far.
And then six numbers after that. You can't even say those numbers.
Just a quick thing. I'm just going to glance at this, but in the time we've been here this evening, since I first got up and spoke to you, Canada's debt has gone up $15 million.
Oh. And that's just the debt, not the spending.
That's the debt. $15 million. With that, I want you to say, I hope you take your money, have yourself a drink, spend some time here. You might as well enjoy it because it may not last. Thank you very much.